picking up something on the satellite? Give me a sec, I'm gonna tune it. Sir, I'm having a little interference. I'm checking it out right now. Hold on. I think we found him. Here we go.
You are listening to Wide Range Media Podcast.
Welcome everyone to a new episode of Wide Range Media. This is episode 72, our soundtrack episode. I'm your host, Adam Figueroa, and my co-hosts are...
I am Pablo.
And this is Ralph Perez from Strange Planet.
And Silvio from About Men Radio.
All right, so let's get into our announcements where we discuss a lot of stuff. There's a lot of new stuff coming up, right? Updates-wise, yeah. So let's just get into announcements.
This week on Announcements.
All right, so we started updating everything. I think we got the Patreon. So yep. Our Patreon tiers are up. So we go to patreon.com/wide range media. We're back on Facebook. You can follow us on facebook.com/wide range media. You could go to our website at widerangemediapodcast.com. T-shirts. Now we have an online store that has sweaters, T-shirts, iPhone cases, coffee mugs on two different alternative black or white, whatever you prefer. And Pablo, anything else?
Twitter, at Wide Range Media. And also, if you like our podcast, please, 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 please leave a review on iTunes. That is the best way you can support our podcast. Even if you want to leave, you don't have to leave a 5-star rating.
But yes, they do.
Nice.
Yeah.
But yes, you do. You have to. But no, definitely leave a review, write a review for us. That would definitely help us climb our charts on iTunes. And that will help us get more followers, more listeners, and we can provide more content for you guys.
Silvio, About Men Radio.
About Men Radio, listen to our podcast there, read our blogs, lots of fun stuff there.
Ralph, Strange Planet NYC.
Well, NYC is my YouTube channel, Strange Planet NYC. You can just go to youtube.com and find it in the search engine. But another thing that's going on is Kevin Mayer is having his Kevin Geeks Out event happening on the 25th of July at 7:30 p.m. And it's a series. It's called A Night of Seven Supercuts, where he goes over not one topic, which has always been the usual, but seven topics, apparently, that are related to TV and movies. So I'm planning on going. I hope to make that one.
All right. And also, we have fan mail came in. A friend of mine texted me, not email, but texted me about he heard the Abbott and Costello bit episode.
Cool.
He said, I listened to the Abbott Costello episode. Tears, bro. Pure tears. Meaning nice. He laughed. And I said, oh, yeah, that's good. And then he goes, that Lucille spot had me rolling. One criticism, though, I also remember Abbott Costello movies being on Channel 11 on Sundays as well. But if you guys forgot to clue in the listeners that Channel 11 /WPIX, local station here in New York /New Jersey, if I'm listening to it in Chicago, I wouldn't know what Channel 11 was.
Yeah, it was local to New York City area.
Yeah.
And then he goes... Mm. And then he goes, other than that, I love the chemistry you guys have. It's great. And I love how the show has evolved. I think you guys really do big things.
We're mutating.
Thank you. Thank you.
But
we're mutating.
We're mutating. But we're other than evolving. That, let's get into discussions at the movies.
This week on Discussions at the Movies.
So this week on Discussions at the Movies, we have two topics. I know there's a lot of news breaking out from CW making a new Batwoman show. We'll break that next week when we have a lot of information on that. But they're finally making a Batman TV show, which is pretty cool. But anyway, topic one is Ed Norton calls out Marvel for bad movie script. So what do you guys think of that?
What?
Is this for the Incredible Hulk?
Yes, The Incredible Hulk that came out in 2006, I believe.
And now he's complaining?
He's always been dogging Marvel.
I think, in my opinion, that he needs to get over himself and move on with his life. Really. The movie came out in 2006, you said, right?
Yeah, I think around
2006. And he didn't want to? I just want to make sure I understand this. He didn't want to continue playing the role?
No. He wanted to continue the role. It's just that that movie itself, they didn't allow him to rewrite. Like, every scenes he rewrote, they took out.
Oh, okay.
So they allowed him to rewrite it, but they just filmed it and they never used it.
I sense a lot of bitterness then from him. And, you know, after a decade of bitterness, I think it's time. I mean, I'm sure he's moved on to other things. I mean, why does he keep on doing that? Like, what's the point?
Here's the thing that I've heard about him, though, is that this guy is notoriously difficult to work with. I mean,
I heard that too.
Yeah. I mean, American History X, which was a breakout role, and I thought it was fantastic the way he transformed himself into that character, but that he was horrendous on the set, everything. It's like every movie he's in, you hear this stuff about him. It's like, come on, dude. It's like Ralph said, this guy's got to get over himself.
Yeah, I mean, I always said, look, the movie itself, I mean, he can say it's a basket. I re-saw it again, and I liked it. I thought it was a good movie.
I liked it the first time I saw it. Yeah. I didn't think it was that bad a movie.
Yeah, me too.
I don't see what's so horrible about it because it continued with every other Marvel movie. They keep referencing the whole movie. Yeah. So
they even did a callback with General Ross.
Yeah, General Ross came back. Yeah. They took the new Bruce Banner talked about the fight in Harlem. That's where he fought the Abomination. He destroyed Harlem. I mean, and then he talked about putting the bullet in his mouth. That was in the new Incredible Hulk movie, too, with Ed Norton. That was in one of the deleted scenes that he put the gun and he shoots it and the Hulk.
Oh, yeah, you're right. They didn't dismiss this movie. Mm-mm. They kept it as part of the universe. They just replaced them.
Yeah.
And maybe this is the reason why they replaced them. Yeah, exactly. Imagine having all these superstars and then you have Ed Norton acting like a kid. Someone's going to punch him in the mouth, from Robert Downey Jr. to Chris Evans. That's
what
I think.
Where the hell does this crap come from? You're an actor. I mean, there are A-list top actors. They don't come in there demanding to rewrite the script.
Come on.
Well, you know what, though? Marvel, again, this was Marvel's second movie, so they were still very early, and they were allowing a lot of things. If this was today, like if anyone came in today, Marvel would have been like, what?
What?
Get out of here.
It's like, we've made $18 billion, they been
like,
dude.
Alex, they would have been like, you lose.
Oh, yeah, they would have did that. They would.
You lose! Good day, sir.
No, but even still, but look, if I had to choose between Ed Norton and Mark Ruffalo, I would pick Ed Norton, hands down. I mean, because I liked him way better as Bruce
Banner.
I don't
know about hands down. I may lean towards Ed Norton. Yes, but not hands down as saying like Mark Ruffalo. Because Mark Ruffalo came
in. I never said, but he did six movies. I mean, compared to Ed Norton, he's been in six movies.
That's the point. But to say hands down, it's like putting Mark Ruffalo down.
I'm not putting Mark Ruffalo down. I'm just saying is that he came into a situation that benefited him. He just came into a role that was already developed by Ed Norton.
No, I think I disagree. With
I think
that.
Ruffalo really changed it. I don't know if changed it, but he definitely made it his own. I think Norton would have done a great job if he had stayed six movies into it. I mean, he is a fantastic actor.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Chemistry would have been great with those guys.
Yeah, but he's too much of a jerk.
No, I mean, you act like a jerk, you're treated like a jerk.
That's right.
Maybe he can go to D.C.
Tell him to go to D.C.
Yeah, I bet you he goes to D.C.
I hear they need a Batman over there.
Oh, yeah. Well, they're going to rewrite a lot of stuff.
And they might need a new Joker.
I'm not with that whole Joker bit. But anyway, next on the topic. Robert Zemeckis said there would never be another Back to the Future as long as he lives, and Bob Gale also.
I agree. Next.
The reason why is because after the, what's his name, Christopher Lloyd came out and said that he's up to doing another movie.
He can't do it again.
Oh, I mean, he's too old.
No, he's in bad shape too. What was it recently, what was, how many years is it for Back to the Future? It was 30 years, 3 years ago.
It's a lot.
In 2015. It's 85. Yeah, it was 85.
Yeah.
But anyway, they did a big thing one of the late night shows. You know, and they brought out the car. They brought out Marty and, you know, Doc.
Michael J. Fogg.
Yeah, yeah. They both were reprising their role and they're trying to do some funny bits and everything. And, you know, it was kind of funny, but I was watching it. I was like cringing a little bit because, you know, we all know that, unfortunately, you know, Michael J. Fox has Parkinson's and, you know, and you could see that that affects him, especially trying to do a live thing on stage there. But what's his face? Christopher Lloyd. I mean, he just looked extremely old. He looked fragile. Yeah. And yeah, he didn't look like he couldn't handle that 10-minute bit. How's he going to handle a movie?
I mean, Michael J. Fox, you could tell he didn't handle that one either. I mean, they said that he can't stay that long on stage until he has to go to the back. But
sure.
I agree with Robert Zemeckis. There's no way in hell. I mean, just like Steven Spielberg said, they would never do his movies reboot either.
So you don't think they would ever
leave it alone.
You don't think they would ever remake it?
No, they will remake
it. Different actors?
No, they will remake it, but they will remake it after those people perish because they're not going to allow it.
You said perish.
Yeah.
It's a volcano exploded or something.
but let's ask this question, guys, because here's a movie that I think all three of us and many agree that it's not only is it a classic, and not only is it probably one of the best movies ever made, but it's a movie that you can watch today. Mm-hmm. And it holds up,
yeah.
Like if it was made
yep.
yesterday.
Yes.
Agreed.
So my question is, what would be the point of making a complete reboot?
You know, you could say that about a handful of movies out there.
You could go down of all the reboots that came out. Why did they have to do that?
Right. Like when I did not like, you know, when Nightmare on Elm Street, when they rebooted that years ago, I was like, why?
Yeah, but if you look at the original Nightmare on Elm Street, it doesn't hold up well. You know, it's very dated, especially the special effects. It's very dated. You look at Back to the Future, and for the most part, those effects still hold up. There may be just one or two little things that they can touch up, but everything holds up. Nightmare on Elm Street does not. Friday the 13th does not. So you can see why they would make a reboot of those type of movies. But here, this one, I don't see any benefit other than maybe doing a what they call the soft reboots or continuation, kind of like what they're doing with Halloween, something like that. Those, if they do something like that with Back to the Future, where let's say it's new cast, but you still have Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd, you know, you bring those actors in and then you surround them with a new cast, and it's a continuation, okay, maybe. But a complete reboot, like a new cast, and just retell the story?
Yeah.
Yeah, not for...
I don't even think it would work with a soft reboot. Because no one's going to care about... Everyone's going to want Marty and Doc to go on the adventure.
Yeah, it's got to be Marty and Doc.
Yeah, but...
Yeah, how do you follow up that?
In terms of Nightmare on Elm Street, Wes Craven had to do a lot of stuff to make Freddy come to screen. Where Back to the Future, it wasn't as much effects. It was pretty much everything was said done, except the car going back to the future. I mean, going through time. But that's easy effects that you could do now on computers. You just erasing the car from the scene. But in terms of Freddy Krueger makeup, I always say when it comes to makeup and stuff, Nightmare on Elm Street is outdated. But for its time of the 1980s, well, that was the best effects that they had, especially when he was stretching his arms out. I mean, now it looks like crap, but
now you look at it, it's kind of like Mardi Gras, you know?
Yeah, but you can never remake because everyone wants Robert Englund to reprise the role. That's why that movie.
There's another guy who's too old to do it.
Yeah, you're not going to bring him an 85-year-old Freddy unless you're going to do a prequel of him before he was Freddy. I will say, oh, okay, that would work. But they didn't go down that route. They went down the whole, he became Freddy Krueger and it bombed. I mean, actually, they made their money back. It didn't bomb. They made a lot of money off of it. But
oh, yeah.
But all right, so let's get into our soundtrack show.
Soundtracks.
So this is going to be fun. You might sing along. You might know the songs.
Uh-oh.
You want to sing along, sing along. You might laugh, you cry. I don't know what you're going to do, but this is going to be a fun topic.
I promise not to sing.
Yeah, so let's go around the table. So, I mean, I have more than three.
Well, let's introduce what it is that we're talking about.
Yeah, so basically, we're going to tell what's our favorite soundtracks that we listen to now.
Okay.
Even working out or you cleaning the house or you doing whatever you're doing. But what soundtracks you put on, regardless if it's a musical that is just music score or if it's a musical soundtrack that you hear voices and all that other stuff behind it. So, yeah.
Well, here's the thing, and I think it's a pretty good opportunity to introduce one of the reasons why we're doing this. We talked about it in a few podcasts ago. I talked about the Soundtrack Show, which is a podcast that I found online, recommended by another podcast that I listened to. And I said, let's give this a try. Very, very good. David W. Collins, who runs it, does a very good job. And that's why we came up with this topic that we're going to share today. To this point, that Pablo was talking about, he does talk about soundtrack and score, because we think of it as two different things. And I'm going to try and remember how he explained it. And, he explains it so well, that a soundtrack is on every movie. It is actually the bars. It's a physical thing that's on the film. Now, of course, we got digital film. It's a little bit different, but the soundtrack resides on the film itself, and it carries musical score, incidental music, foley sounds. It carries a lot of things. So the soundtrack comprises of a lot more than just the score. I think what we're trying to talk about today is scores that we like from movie soundtracks. And that might be a little bit of a difference. One thing that was very interesting that David also mentioned in his show is that silent movies actually have a soundtrack. As odd as that might sound, it might sound like an oxymoron, but there is.
But it was live.
Exactly. Exactly. So that is considered the soundtrack of a silent movie. So just without any further ado, let's talk about the scores that we like.
All right. I'll go around the table. Go ahead.
How do we want to do it? Do we want to do one each? Or do we talk do about our three?
Since we're doing top three, let's all mention our number three, then okay. We all mention our number two,
yeah.
And we all mention our number one. Mm-hmm. How's that?
Okay, yeah. That's cool.
Cool.
Yep. Who's going first?
Go ahead, start it off. Everyone's
me?
Like, yeah, start it off, Ralph.
I
want to
hear Silvio. I want to hear Silvio's number three.
Silvio has like the scratching, the...
No, he actually has the live orchestra from the black and white films.
Yeah, from Metropolis. I have the soundtrack of Metropolis.
So, all right. So, what's your number three?
My number three is Last of the Mohicans.
What?
Last of the Mohicans actually started as an electronic score.
You say what?
Huh?
Rob said what? Did you say what?
Yes,
Rob?
I did.
Okay. Have you seen Last of the Mohicans?
No.
Okay, remember that topic I mentioned earlier today? That might be one for you.
Yeah, I guess that's part of it, right?
But anyway,
okay, give me some background on that.
Last of the Mohicans has a very good...
It's not horror. It's not Ralph's.
That's why.
It's not up his alley. Has a very good score that was commissioned to be done by Trevor Jones. And he was originally told to put together an electronic score. But late into the development of the movie, they decided to go orchestral. So you can imagine, here's this guy who devoted his time to write this electronic score for this movie. Now all of a sudden he has to change it around and make it an orchestral to fit the theme of the movie a little bit better. And he just could not meet all the deadlines, so they ended up bringing in Randy Edelman to fill in the blanks, and they co-credited together. It is a fantastic score, but because of this co-credit, they were not eligible for an Oscar, and it's not just me saying it, they were definitely should have been up there in that year for an Oscar. The main, there's a tune in there that's pretty famous.
Thank you.
called I Will Find You. And if you guys saw the movie, everybody but Ralph will remember it in that scene. That was very, very good. And that was done by a Scottish songwriter. And his name is, it was performed by Clannad, which is a Scottish.
Clannad. You know? Yeah, okay. I know who that is. That's a woman, right?
It's a great song, I Will Find You. It's from Last of the Mohicans. Now that you know that part of it, Ralph, you got to fill in the blanks and watch the rest of the movie.
I better make it a point.
Ralph, go ahead. What's your number three?
My number three is...
Hereditary.
Shut up. It's... It's actually Superman.
Oh!
Superman. The original Superman.
Very good.
There you go.
Oh, that's look the at joint that.
Very yeah. nice.
Good time. That's right. Superman. The soundtrack written by John Williams.
Williams, yes, sir.
And John Williams is the, like, king of the movie soundtracks. Yep. All bow before John Williams because he's done, you know, he's pretty much done it all. And with Superman, when they brought Superman back, with Christopher Reeve back in, what was it, 1978 or 79? You know, I always, this is how I used to do this. I used to buy the soundtracks on vinyl, okay? On Fordham Road, there was a store called Crazy Eddie.
Yes,
on Fordham Crazy Road Eddie. In the Bronx.
Crazy Eddie's greatest TV and video sale ever. Get a video recorder, color TV, large screen TV, video camera, even an audio video component system. Get it all on sale now during Crazy Eddie's greatest TV and video sale ever. Remember, we are not undersold. We will not be undersold. We cannot be undersold. And we mean it. So get anything and everything in TV and video. Get it now during Crazy Eddie's greatest TV and video sale ever. Crazy Eddie, his prices are insane.
And that's why
our prices are insane.
And I used to go there to buy my stuff. Now, I would also go to the Wiz on 3rd Avenue.
Nobody beats the Wiz.
Now 10 great superstores with the opening of its newest store at 12 West 45th Street. Manhattan, the Bronx, Queens, Brooklyn, and Newark.
Nobody beats the Wiz.
Nobody beats the Wiz.
Both stores, by the way, went out of business.
So, no, I went to, I would usually go to Crazy Eddie, actually, and buy soundtracks there on vinyl. Superman was one of those. I still own that soundtrack to this day.
Nice.
When I was in high school, when I started my first year in high school, I used to really heavily listen to soundtracks of all different kinds of movies. That was one of them. And I would attribute the themes to whatever I was feeling that day, whether I was angry, whether I was in love, whether I was, you know, just in a kind of static state. I would just put on Superman. And I would, you know, it was between the main theme and the love theme with him and Lois Lane. Those two themes are amazing. Not to mention the theme when you see Krypton for the first time. Remember that?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That was pretty good.
Yeah,
you know, like it really held you to your seat when you saw that. Nice. So that's something that always stayed with me to this day. I used to, forget it. I used to always mess around on the toy keyboards and kind of like try to find the dun, 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 you know, on the freaking keyboard just to learn it because I was so, I loved it. I just love the string sections. I love the arrangement. You know, I started getting into music quite early before I even learned how to play an instrument. Long before. So Superman did it for me.
Pablo?
Okay, two quick things before I get
to
my
Jesus
number three.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
No, it'll be quick. It's just two quick stories that I want to share.
Stories? Yeah, story. We're doing a soundtrack show. We're getting stories. Like you
first, all right. First, the Superman soundtrack.
Okay.
Superman soundtrack was the only 8-track that we had at the house that I remember.
Oh, okay.
And we had an 8-track player, and that was the only 8-track that we had around was the Superman soundtrack.
So when you felt like listening to Superman, you said, where's the 8-track player?
Exactly. And the second story is, the first time I ever went to Crazy Eddie was to buy my 3D glasses because Channel 11 was, they started running the old
Creature
black and white.
From the Black Lagoon.
Yes, all the black and white horror movies, they turned them into 3D. And remember, you need your 3D glasses. Yeah. And Crazy Eddie had them.
I had mine from Burger King. Burger King were doing promos for that too.
You got yours, but yeah, I went to Crazy Eddie's to get mine.
Yeah, I went to Burger King.
Well, I could have bought myself a Happy Meal and maybe. Yeah.
Happy Meals, they didn't have Happy Meals in Burger King yet.
Mm. And I heard Crazy Eddie's, wasn't he like involved in like tax fraud or something like that?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, well, he was the spokesperson. He wasn't really the actual.
The spokesperson for tax fraud. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, he was involved. It was a whole mess.
Crazy Eddie. All right, my number three just so happens to be the best-selling soundtrack of all time. With over 45 million units sold. Just saying.
Oh, okay. Well, there goes that all piece of paper.
My number three is Saturday Night Fever. And when I was putting together this list, I wanted to have some criteria. And one of them was a CD or an album or now streaming that I recently played because I wanted to hear it again. And one that I've played often and sometimes. And this guy, he found it on his phone.
Yeah. I see Pablo getting dressed for the prom. He's like, ooh, you look good. You look fly.
Here I come, Gladys.
Actually, my favorite song is How Deep Is Your Love. I love that song. I think that's one of the best written songs ever. Anyway.
It's an amazing, amazing
song. Yeah, just picture that. Pablo's from...
This revived the Bee Gees' careers because they weren't doing too well. And they didn't join this project until the movie was in post-production. And a lot of the dancing that they did was to other songs, like Stevie Wonder songs. But then when they came in post-productions, they went back and redid some of the scenes and they threw in the Bee Gees song. So, yeah, definitely Saturday Night Fever, one of my all-time favorite soundtracks.
You know what's funny about that real quick, if I could just jump? The Bee Gees were more known for folk in the early 70s. You know, they had a more acoustic-y, folkish kind of thing going with them. But then when the disco era kicked in, they jumped on that. And to this day, that's what they're best known for. They're not known for their earlier stuff. They're known for Saturday Night Fever. It's amazing. It's amazing.
Which is the one that's still alive? There's only one of them alive.
None. They all died.
Really? No.
One died.
Barry?
No.
Barry.
Barry.
Which Bee Gees is still alive?
Why are you asking her? Oh, snap.
Barry. Barry's still alive.
I thought you were talking to the...
You asked the Oracle?
Oracle.
Right. Let me ask the Oracle. Hey!
Which BG is still alive? Barry!
Thank you, Oracle.
Thank you, Oracle. That's Pablo getting ready for the prom.
Staying alive!
And Silvio, get out the bathroom! Come on, man! No, but for me, my number three... it's gonna be weird, but I always thought that my number three, I think has the best soundtrack for all 28 films. I'll just play it, and then everyone will know what I'm talking about.
Cut. 30 seconds.
Really,
No, no, I already, they're all set for 30 seconds.
Austin Powers?
No, it's not Austin Powers.
No, but I mean, in terms of 007, in terms of, I mean, every movie has like an iconic main song.
Yeah, it identifies it.
Right.
Yeah, identifies the movie. And I always thought that's pretty cool. I mean, even when you're watching the movie, it takes you along the journey with the spy. I don't know. I just like, that's my number three, is 007 James Bond.
That's awesome.
Next, Silvio? Why?
Oh, dang. He wanted to jump right into it. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not telling no stories like you people, man. I just, 007. You figure it out. Watch it. Watch 007. You got 28 movies to go. Go ahead.
All right. Well, my number two is probably the second soundtrack actual vinyl that I bought. Because in 1977, this came out in December. And my first one was earlier in that same year. But it's the same one that Pablo picked. It's Saturday Night Fever. Yeah. And
you got Saturday Night Fever too, as number two?
Yep, that was my number two.
Y'all couldn't share it? Y'all couldn't share the album? You had to buy separate copies?
You know, Pablo stole my thunder. You know, and it's the best-selling soundtrack of all time. 45 million sold. 16 times platinum in the USA. It's also in the National Registry for the Library of Congress. So they preserved it as something that deserves to, you know, be maintained for the rest of the world, or for the rest of history to still listen to at some point, even though it was all disco and everybody hates disco so much. But anyway, it's true. I mean, you know, people still say, oh, disco was the worst thing about the 70s. Like, no, it wasn't. I mean,
no, it wasn't.
No. Well, hey, I'm not saying it. I like disco. I enjoyed it. I lived through it. You know, it bridged my 70s to 80s. You know, unfortunately, I was too young to enjoy disco all the way through. But yeah, I did grow up listening to it. And
Pablo mentioned, too young to go to Studio 54.
Yeah, definitely. I went to it after it was.
When it got closed.
Well, they closed it. Then they brought it back. When they brought it back in the early 80s, that's when I visited Studio 54. But anyway, fun facts. Pablo was already talking about it. John Travolta was dancing to Boz Scaggs and Stevie Wonder because the Bee Gees were actually brought into it very late into post-production. Incidental music was composed by David Shire. And that was the music for the Verrazano Bridge and all that very orchestral disco-y sound that followed the movie. Yeah, the best songs from it, Staying Alive, Night Fever, How Deep Is Your Love. And I know Pablo said his How Deep Is Your Love is his personal favorite. I like You Should Be Dancing.
Oh, that's
it. And it was a great part in that movie, too. So.
You should be dancing. Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't promise I'm listening to that funk guitar in there.
You know, I remember seeing that movie when I was very young.
I watched it a couple of weeks ago.
And I saw it maybe a couple of years ago. Again, and it's a strong, it's a very strong movie.
It really is. Yeah, I mean, we could probably use that as a topic if we wanted to, but I just saw it like 2 weeks ago. You know, my wife's like, "What are you watching Saturday Night?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I just wanted to put something else on." And, you know, I'm watching it, and it's true. There were some deep things in there.
There were.
You know, his brother who was a priest who had lost his faith and was leaving. That whole old Italian family, if one of the members of the family became a priest, that was something for these old Italian mothers. It was like, oh my God, yes, that means we're all saved. And then when he was leaving it, you know, it became a mess. And of course, they took it out on John Travolta. You know, that part of it was deep. His friend who was going through that thing where he gets his girlfriend pregnant, and then he ends up actually committing suicide in front of them because they weren't paying attention to him. You know, and then, of course, the whole, you know, between the Hispanics and the Italians.
He gave it away.
Spoiler, sorry.
You spoiled it?
Doctor Spoiler.
Did I spoil a 40-year-old movie? But anyway. And we get all this information about the Verrazano Bridge that, you know.
I thought that was the Brooklyn Bridge.
That was the Verrazano.
The Verrazano.
Yeah, you got to go back and watch it.
Ralph?
Number two. again, I have to admit, and you know this is in my, this was going to be in my list. I know you all know this. Star Wars.
Star Wars
is my number two favorite soundtrack of all time. I bought the soundtrack of Star Wars. That's right. There's nothing like it, baby. Nothing like it. And the truth is, you know, again, just like the Superman soundtrack, I used to listen. I used to just go to my room after school, put the disc on, put on my headphones, lay on my bed, close my eyes, and put myself in that world. I just put myself in that world. And, you know, and there was nobody else to bother me. It was just me, my music, and my imagination. And the music was just amazing. Like, you know, it was funny because it was around that time that I started really paying attention to the different instruments in the soundtrack.
You know, voice started changing too?
No.
At that time? Not that change?
No. Actually, yeah, probably. But I wasn't. I was thinking about the music, like the from the soundtrack, how you can hear the violins from the different sections, and and the brass section, and all that kind of stuff. You know, it's like you. I started, and to see how they worked together, and to make this symphony, to make this mood, that became part of the what is to this day. The Star Wars universe. Star Wars Episode 9 comes out next year. Okay? J.J. Abrams is directing it, and John Williams already said, this is my last one. This is my swan song, guys. That's deep. He's done all of them. He's done the soundtrack for every Star Wars film, at least in the trilogies, in the main trilogies to date. And that is just amazing. And my favorite one sends chills down my spine, because when I saw at the very end, when I heard this theme coming, and you see Luke and Han and Chewbacca coming down the stairs of the ancient Jedi Temple on Yavin 4, approaching Princess Leia to get their medals, sent chills down my spine.
Chewie didn't get one.
And Chewie didn't get one. Chewie didn't get one.
That's discrimination,
that's
man.
Messed up. But maybe they ran out. But... this was the time. This was the time to enjoy. This was the time to just be young and enjoy these soundtracks. And I did.
Pablo.
All right, my number two. My number two sold 28 million copies, making it one of the best-selling albums of all time, ranking among the biggest-selling soundtrack albums of all time. And this is one of my favorite movies. I love this movie. I've seen it so many times.
Runaway?
No, not Runaway.
Yo, I was about to say that. I was about to say.
I still have my number one spot. So.
And you beat me to it. Yeah, that's right.
My number two is Grease.
Very good. Yes.
Yeah. I love the movie and I love the music.
Oh my God.
And as a kid, I mean, I don't know if I should say this, but as a kid, I had the album on vinyl and I used to play it all the time.
All the time.
And I wanted to be John Travolta.
That's right.
So,
well, we already kind of got that already from earlier.
Yeah. So my mom got me a black shirt, you know, cut off sleeves. And she took me to Woolworths, and she bought the studs, and she put the studs around the shirt, so I can walk around like John Travolta.
I got some stories too.
And they had and on TV they would sell these how to dance like John Travolta, like this instruction.
Unbelievable.
And they would sell, like, it was a booklet. It came with a tape. It also came with, like, these footprints that you would put on the floor to simulate his steps and how to move and all that. And I always wanted that. And I still remember that infomercial. But yeah, but sadly, I was never able to get that that instruction.
You couldn't get the grease moves.
I couldn't get the chance of all the moves.
If I can add to Pablo's story here, right after that movie came out, we moved to Argentina, and Pablo would dance the Travolta routine for all our cousins who were meeting him for the first time. But anyway, yes.
He's like, I got chills that are multiplying. And I'm losing control.
I got chills, they're multiplying. And I'm losing control.
One of the reasons Pablo won't go back to Argentina.
What?
Our cousin's the last.
I disgrace our name.
First of all, that. Everybody on family. Oh, you're the guy who did the dance. Dance for us.
Oh, that's too funny.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God.
Good pick.
We're okay. It's okay.
Yeah, that's too funny. I'm picturing Pablo.
Oh, my God.
Right. He was 6 years old at the time.
Honey, what do you want?
Oh, with my black shirt cut off with the little sparkles. Studs.
Sparkles.
Right, wait. They weren't sparkles, all right? Okay, they were sterling silver. Okay?
Oh, okay.
And my mom, you know, with love and care, she put it together. And okay. She made me that shirt in. Yeah. Yeah. There were no sparkles.
Sparkles.
That was great.
Oh, my God.
You want to hear a crazy theme, theory or something that I heard not a few years back?
Yes. That's an awesome. Yes. So a couple of years ago, someone on Reddit posted a theory that in the beginning of the movie, she dies. She drowns and dies.
Yes.
Right? The whole scene when they're at the beach.
Right.
So then the rest of the movie is her being, actually, she doesn't die. She's in a coma. So the rest of the movie is her being in a coma, and then at the end she dies. And remember, at the end they're in the car, and the car kind of like takes off.
Yeah.
And she like looks surprised, and she looks behind, and then she's waving as the car's like taking off. And everybody's wondering why would a car take off, and you know, in the playland that they're there. And that was that she died, and she's going to heaven. She finds that. So the whole movie was her being.
So basically, it was Jacob's Ladder, the prequel.
But with music.
Oh, Lord.
We go together like
Mama. Walla 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 walla. Anyway,
so that's my number two.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. Remember that one? Grease?
Get low.
Hand job.
Get low. Yes.
That was the best one. That was the best one. When they were dancing. Oh,
how low can you go?
How low can you go?
A lot of good songs on that. Grease Lightning.
How low?
That's the dance Grease. That he would actually do is the Grease Lightning.
Oh, Grease Lightning.
Oh, Grease Lightning. Ooh, Grease Lightning.
I don't know the words. So
oh, Grease Lightning. Go, Grease Lightning.
Oh. I don't know the words. I'm sorry.
No, but so my number two.
Okay.
I'm not doing no album sales or nothing. I'm just going straight into it and going straight to Silvio. I don't ain't doing
album
no
sales.
That.
You think we're trying to sell the records here, Alex?
This one sold 150 million, brother.
Well, you mentioned it. We probably know the fun facts. Go ahead.
This album, actually, I think it's one of the best soundtracks. I think, period. But it's my number two because my number one is going to be the best one. But I think Back to the Future has one of the best soundtracks. So I'm going to play you some snippets, and then you get to see it. So this is the theme song. And then one of my favorite scenes in the movie is when Marty jumps onto the DeLorean and the guys are after him in the van.
Yeah.
The Libyans.
Remember? And he's driving. Yeah. And then every time, Like, I love the way Robert Zemeckis teases you because you see the speedometer going up to 80 and then it drops because he's taking turns. And I was like, because every watch it, I was like, this is awesome because you get to see it go up and then it drops down. And I'm like, whoa. But then when you saw him whip out the missile launcher, I was like, oh, as a kid, that always got me nuts because I was like, this is so awesome. And then then the music is what Silverman.
Alan Silverman.
Is it Alan Silverman?
Yeah, Alan Silverman. Yeah. He plays with it, and it's one of the best, I think, that point. When he goes, let's see you bastards do 85 miles per hour. And
actually,
then,
let's see if you bastards can do 90.
Yeah. And then,
so, to get to 90, of course, obviously, he has to hit 88 first.
That's what he's driving. He's going, he's turning the corner. And that's when he looks in the mirror. The guy whips out the missile launcher. And then that's when he goes, and it goes, and then all the lights hit for the first time. And I was like, oh my God. And then it just goes, pew, pew, pew. I'm telling you, it's like, that was amazing. I thought that the whole Power of Love was amazing too.
Oh, Huey Lewis. Remember that?
Yeah. Yes. That's a cool song.
Yeah.
And he's in the movie.
He's the principal.
He's in the movie, yes.
No, he's not the principal.
He's the guy with the.
No, he's the talent show guy, yes.
Yeah.
You guys are too darn loud.
I would love. Yeah.
And then Michael J. Fox gets on stage in front of his parents.
This guy had prepared a whole thing. Where was that?
That's better than what? I think it's good. But anyway, he got on stage and then he started to play. And he did actually play I don't know if he played this. I think he
plays guitar.
Yeah. So. And he sang too. Don't sounded pretty good too.
Johnny B. Goode.
Thirty seconds is up, my bad. I'll give you a little bit though. Go, Johnny, go, go.
Go, Johnny, go, go.
Go, Johnny, go, go. Go, Johnny, go, go, go. Johnny, be good.
No, but seriously though, nice. I'm thinking. I think Back to the Future has one of the best soundtracks from beginning to end when you're watching the movie. You can follow it. It's a great movie. But anyway, Silvio, let's go to your top number one.
Oh, my number one.
What you got for your number one?
Yeah, I mentioned earlier that Saturday Night Fever 1977 in December was my second soundtrack I ever bought on vinyl. My first one I bought earlier that year in 1977. And of course, it was Star Wars. Star Wars, not on opening night, not the opening week. It might have been 2 or 3 weeks after it opened up. Very different than the way blockbusters open up today. Star Wars opened very quietly in New York, downtown. There was only like 2 theaters in the Bronx that were showing it. One was one of the Fordham RKOs. I don't remember which one.
That's where I first saw it.
Okay, yep. And there was another one in the Bronx showing it somewhere out there. I saw it downtown with a friend and his parents or family, and we went and saw it together and blown away, totally blown away. And like I said, it might have been the 3rd or 4th week that it came out, you know, and nobody knew. This came out of nowhere, and, you know, and we're watching this thing, and here I am, a 12-year-old boy watching this, you know, very different from any sci-fi that we had seen at the time. And the one thing that struck me, you know, just like you guys were mentioning earlier of the throne room scene at the end without music, what it would be like, you know, But I wasn't thinking in those terms. All I was getting was this visual, incredible visuals, and this amazing music that I had never heard before, really, at that orchestral level. Why? Because Hollywood had started to get away from that big orchestral sound. And something that I learned from the soundtrack show, talking about George Lucas, that's something that he brought back, that there was a very classical composer of early orchestral scores for Hollywood, and he wanted that type of a feel for it. And when he put together the edit of the movie before he handed it over to John Williams, who he found John Williams through his good buddy Steven Spielberg, and he asked him, who should I go to? And Steven Spielberg said, hey, this guy I've been working with, Johnny Williams, and he called him Johnny.
Boom.
did a great job for me, you know, obviously for Jaws and in a previous movie. He says, you can work with him well. And he went to him and he brought him his movie with a lot of temp scoring, temp music. And a lot of that music was music from this old orchestral composer. And John Williams took it from there and, you know, used a full piece. It was the London Symphony Orchestra. It was the first time he was directing an orchestra like the London Symphony Orchestra, put it all together, and just came out with a fantastic score that I bought on a 2-album set. It was just this big black album, and it just said Star Wars on it. And I played that thing to death. I must have worn it out. I had cassettes of it. Ralph was saying about going to sleep with it. Yeah. Remember those old cassette players? You know,
I used to record. I used to make tapes.
Oh, so did I. I mean, you push both play and record at the same time, and you could record and you know, just hit play, and the batteries would go on it, you know, real quick. But anyway, yeah, I would put that on at night, put my headphones on, and just go to sleep listening to Star Wars.
That's right.
And that was the way to do it. Fantastical. One of the things that I just rediscovered this score again was through listening to the soundtrack show, and David W. Collins. He's a huge nerd, just like all of us. And he has the type of thing that us nerds look up to. He actually worked for Lucasfilms for over a decade, working on their video game scores and things of that nature. He's a composer. He's worked on the theater and all of that. So he was very involved with Star Wars, and he loves Star Wars as much as we do. So one of the things that he has done is he has created a spreadsheet where he tracks every part of little themes and the actors that are part of it, and tracks it throughout the whole thing. And listening to him talk about it in the soundtrack show, I went back to rewatch Star Wars with some of these things in mind, and it was fantastic. It was really fantastic to rediscover certain things of it. Things that I loved just enjoying it. For example, when Luke is looking at the twin sons of Tatooine coming down.
I still get goosebumps when
right. I'm listening to his podcast and he's playing part of that, and I'm driving and I'm getting goosebumps. And I said, I just got to go and rewatch it. And I'm rewatching it, and it almost brings you to tears of how good that part of it is.
It's amazing. It's amazing. It just started something that we'll always have.
Absolutely. You know, and after that, of course, you know, I'm not going to say to John Williams, this made him great. The man is great. But that orchestral part of it, he did it with Close Encounters. He did it with Indiana Jones. He did it with Jurassic Park. It's just phenomenal. The body of work that came out after things like Jaws and Star Wars. But Star Wars is still the top soundtrack for me.
Ralph, next.
Okay, my number one soundtrack is something related to the horror genre. It is the most famous theme in the horror genre. Halloween.
Halloween.
soundtrack that I loved more than anything else was not so much the first Halloween film, but the soundtrack to the second one, the one that came out in 1981.
The one that doesn't exist anymore.
Now does not exist in the damn canon but that's okay. I'm over that. But this soundtrack was made with John Carpenter. John Carpenter did the soundtrack to that. He didn't direct Halloween 2.
No, that's right. Yeah.
But he still did the score for it with help with this other guy, Alan Howarth, who's helped him with the soundtrack of many other movies ever since. And it was that you see in the original Halloween soundtrack, it's mostly done with piano and some other stuff. But with Halloween 2, it is done with synthesizers. So you do hear a difference. But there are certain tracks in that soundtrack that are so eerie. And it kind of lends to the whole, not to the whole grotesque and horror of Michael Myers, but to the mystery of it. That's why I love Halloween 2 so much. Because the music really helped aid the whole concept of things of what Dr. Loomis, played by Donald Pleasance, was talking about through that film. How Halloween wasn't, he said this in the film, Halloween isn't about ghosts and goblins and witches. It's about the unconscious mind. We're all afraid of the dark within ourselves. Right? And with this music in the background, as he's talking all this, I'm there. I'm like totally following this. Okay? And then the nurse trying to leave the hospital and finding that the flat, all the tires in the parking lot were like, air was taken out of all of them. They were all cut up. Michael Myers cut it up so nobody could leave. So she runs back into the hospital. And you hear this.
He knew exactly which car it was.
No, he cut them all. All the cars in the lot. All the cars in the lot.
That must have taken a long time.
Yeah, that...
Can you just picture if they shot that
scene? It wasn't a big lot.
Of Michael Myers taking the air out.
It wasn't a shopping mall.
All the cars.
He just stabs it.
It was a little rinky dink.
Yeah, he runs.
It was
to
a little
the next
parking
one.
Lot.
Like, which car is hers? I don't know. Let's just get all of them.
He finishes up with the five cars and he's all happy. He looks up and there's like 10 more cars. Like, oh, damn.
Another lot on the other side. He's like, oh, my goodness.
No, there's an actual soundtrack piece on that soundtrack called Flats in the Parking Lot. And it sounds so amazing. It's true. It's true. And if you look it up,
I'm
telling you, it's there. It's there. It's creepy as hell.
Flats in the Parking Lot.
It's called Flats in the Parking Lot. And it was amazing. And again, it lent to the mystery of Michael Myers. It the theme. Just, I used to listen to it all the time. I used to make tapes of it. I used to be like, oh, snap, here comes Michael Myers. And my mother used to think I was crazy. I'm like, what are you doing this music of the maniac killer? But there was a mystery there. Michael Myers does a mystery to him. And the music exemplifies that. And that's why I love Halloween 2. That's my number one. Always.
Pablo?
All right. My number one is so awesome and so amazing that they don't even have a Wikipedia page for it, sadly. So, but my number one all-time movie soundtrack is The Karate Kid. I spoke about this in the past.
Really?
Did you? I don't remember which episode.
Yeah, I talked about this. That I love this soundtrack. That I remember buying it on cassette tape. And I mean, I was much older, so I was already into metal, and I would go to the record store. And record stores back then were kind of small, so people knew what you were buying. So. And every week I would go in and I would buy, Anthrax and Slayer and Metallica and Testament, and then one week I bought Karate Kid.
You bought the Karate Kid.
So I was.
Which movie? The first one?
Yeah, the first one.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, the first one.
But
yeah.
The second one is, you know, Peter Cetera, you know, Glory of Love.
Yeah, but no one talks about that one.
I do.
It doesn't exist, like Halloween 2.
Yeah, like Halloween 2.
You don't understand.
And anyway, Karate Kid is just the soundtrack. And if you guys saw Cobra Kai, you know that soundtrack is sprinkled throughout the whole series. And it's just an amazing soundtrack. Not only the songs, but the score as well. The score as well. So anyway, my favorite is the Karate Kid.
My number one is the Rocky IV soundtrack.
Four?
That's hands down.
You know, we can talk through the music.
And then the cool thing about Rocky IV is that each song has a music video, because if you cut off those parts of him working out and him getting all depressed when Apollo died, it was a music video. So it's now true. You got no easy way out. He locks the door in the white car.
I remember that.
Turns it on and it goes.
They used to show those videos.
Yeah. I mean, they're all montages. He's like the king of montage.
Yeah, the whole movie's a montage.
Training montage.
It is what it is, but it's a great montage. Yeah.
There's no easy way out. There's no shortcut home. There's no easy way out. Giving in can be wrong.
And then, of course, he goes to Russia. And you know one here could do the workouts he did in that movie. I don't know. This dude was tearing it up on camera. I don't want to hear it. He's like, this is the rope. And I was like, holy crap. I was like, oh. Oh, him lifting the boulders with his steroid body. He's like, oh. Oh, man. And then he goes, Drago!
Yeah.
That's my joint. He's like, bah, 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 bah. Oh, and then I got Ralph's joint.
That last one, yeah.
You know, Survivor did a song for there, too, even though they were more well-known for Eye of the Tiger in Rocky 3. They had a
Rocky
song
3,
for this
yeah.
one, too.
Oh, I know they did. It got the Burning Heart.
Yeah.
I just didn't put it on the board.
Well, that was Rocky 3, that one there.
But I got your joint, Ralph.
Oh, don't here worry. We go.
I know. Yeah!
Did he write this for this movie?
Yes.
He did. Yeah.
And then he did Ralph's part too.
Yeah. New Orleans.
New Orleans.
He draws it out.
He draws it out.
He did all that and Apollo died. He had that whole get
that
up and Apollo
thing,
died.
And then he died. Oh no.
He got spoiler. His ass whooped.
Spoiler alart.
That's true.
Yeah. Think about
Apollo
it.
Died. Play your spoiler yeah. alert. You get that.
Oh, everyone knows Rocky IV.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Everyone knows Rocky IV. Oh my god. No, but that's, I mean, that's funny though. He keeps showboating and Dolph Lundgren's like, I'm gonna hit this dude mad hard. He's like, once give me an opening, I'm gonna hit you so hard, your ancestors gonna feel it. That's what he did. He sucked the soul out of him when he hit him in the corner.
He said, your ancestors are gonna feel it.
I thought Rocky IV had a great soundtrack. I mean, not even when I'm running, I'm listening to this stuff. That was episode 72. Catch you later.